So the customized planning meeting is a meeting that makes a connection between who the job seeker is and the where for employment. So it's taking you through a process of trying to figure out all of that based on the information that you've collected in this profile. And it's going to create a vision of where the job seeker will be at their best in a work setting. It's really important to remember that the meeting's about employment, not about the whether the person can work. So you really are going to do some work in preparation with anyone in the person's life who might have questions about that in their mind. You're really going to want to prepare for anyone at the meeting who is thinking that way and be prepared to gear the meeting towards, we know that this person can work, because the whole process of discovery is you're going to that meeting with information that is going to lead to a job. That doesn't mean that it's always fast, because the more challenges the person has, the fewer tasks they can do, the less likely it is that you're quickly going to find the employer, although you might, because life, there's a lot of luck in life. The outcomes of the meeting is we're translating who the person is to the employment perspective, so we're always keeping the employment lens, and we're getting a blueprint of the ideal characteristics of employment. So we're looking at the conditions, we're looking at the person's interests, and we're looking at their contributions. Those are the three major things that we're bringing together in this meeting, and we're coming out with outcomes. We're going to come out with a list of the potential tasks the job seeker offers the employer. So again, it's really important. We're not looking for a job title. We're looking for tasks that the person does in their life, translated to kinds of tasks that an employer might need. And the translation part is the difficult part, and that's why when I talk later about how we've done this work, the team working as teams of people to help, where everybody's providing information about what's out there and ideas is really helpful. We're going to come up with then a prioritized list of actual possible employers in the community, and that's coming hopefully from not only your ideas as a job employment specialist, but people in the room. And you're going to be generating as many ideas of who are the actual employers, not categories of employer. And when we first started doing this, one of the mistakes we did is we didn't do enough preparation before the meeting, and we'd come up with ideas of kinds of employers, but not actual potential employers. It's really important to do that legwork so that everyone can actually visualize what it's going to look like. We're going to want to be generating names and connections to employers, so you're actually, to the extent that that people in the room have connections, and in a way, the smaller the community you are, the better, that the more connections you're going to find. You're going to find somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody. Even in New York City, we find that, but it doesn't happen quite as much. And there may be assignments. So we actually, in one of our planning meetings, we had a young man who was very interested in theater and had done some theater and wanted to do some backup work in a theater company. And his transition coordinator actually had a friend who worked in a theater, and she was assigned to go out and make that connection. And this was actually a pretty sad story up until that point, because it had taken forever for him to get eligibility in both the VR system and our DD system for no fault of, it was just one of those bureaucratic messes. And then we were able to actually get him a job within 2 months. So it was like, phew. The topics that we discuss at the meeting are, this is kind of the list, and I'm gonna go through them so you don't have to look at this particular list right now. But what we do in a planning meeting is we have a meeting, hopefully someplace that is not, there aren't distractions, so generally it's not a good idea to do it in people's homes, because there's always a phone that's ringing or something that's pulling people out. So this is the one area where we actually try to make sure that it's in a business environment. But if the people can't travel, you can have that. You can have it at a library, at a conference room, at a community center, but someplace where you're not going to be distracted. And we actually put, this is where we're very low tech. We put big charts of white paper on the wall, and we actually kind of move back and forth through those charts so that you're getting a real picture of where the possibilities. So this is what these charts look like. The first exercise is like a really fun ice-breaking exercise. It's you look at what works and what doesn't work for the person. So this is where you're going to say, you know, what works for me is helping in childcare classes in this case. What works for me is hours that start from, you know, at noon because I know I get up late. What works for me is a quiet environment, or what works for me is when a lot of people are around, and then what doesn't work. And there you're beginning to get at some of the conditions for employment, and you're also getting, there may be particular interests that are really important for the person, and so that works. And what doesn't work may be someplace far away from home because I can't get there. So that's, you're really kind of fleshing that out. And what's nice about this chart is it just gets everything kind of flowing and percolating, and it becomes like a real brainstorming meeting, which is the purpose of it. We used to think that this was like the most important chart until we got a new training, like a refresher training that was provided for our whole community. And all of a sudden we learned this was just an ice-breaking exercise. We thought, oh, this is the best part of the whole thing. So it is a really good thing. Then the next section is going to be conditions, and I think conditions, is aside from the tasks, is really, really the most important part of this process. It is so easy when we're working with people with disabilities, and or if we've got a family member who's a person with a disability, it is so easy to think of obstacles as things that are forbidding, rather than obstacles as just conditions that shape how we're going to approach something. And so what we're doing is we're taking the challenges, and instead of thinking of them as obstacles, we're saying, what has to be in place for this not to matter? Or what has to be in place for this to be able to work anyway? And that, so we're talking about, you know, the location, inside and outside work, the kind of environment, if somebody has trouble making themselves understood, the kind of people that need to be around, the fact that you want to have the same people around so they get used to understanding the person. All of those things are not prohibitions, they're conditions. So I just want to emphasize, this is like really, really important. And we're going to have a condition, you're going to have a chart of those conditions. The important thing is to make sure that preferences don't become conditions. And this is, or that interests don't become conditions in this, unless they really are. And so this is my story of shame, which is, we had a young man who was actually, in the end, I don't think he really needed support employment. Once we got him a really good job that was well matched, we were able to fade support. We kept support much longer than we probably needed to. But initially, he came to us, he was a man the label they would have been Asperger's. He had some mild communication and social issues, but he had a very hard time finding jobs because he had these difficulties in getting through the interviewing process and the application process. He was looking for a clerical job, which are very, very hard jobs to find. And he was quite highly skilled because he was really good with numbers and details and things like this. This is where we got caught up. First of all, it is really hard to find, you know, clerical jobs with a lot of hours in this economy. But where we got caught up is that he was very interested in sports statistics. And through discovery, everybody got very excited about his interest in sports and the fact that he was doing sports statistics. We turned that interest into a condition without even knowing it. We spent a year and a half looking for a job for him in among all those, you know, ESPN has headquarters in New York City, all these sports places. We tried to get into them, and it was really hard to get in, especially when we had young employment specialists doing it. At a certain point, we just finally stopped, and we said, wait a minute, we've got to take a look again. He had all of these tasks and skills he could do. That interest was an interest. It would have been nice if we could have matched him. It would have been good to spend maybe a month and a half, you know, 2 months maybe. Once we looked at the tasks he could do and an environment that was good for him, we were able to customize a job at a law firm where he's working in like four different departments. And he's doing financial, he's doing some data entry of fiscal things in one department. He's doing packets for the HR department. He's doing work in the records room, and he's doing work that involves filing. It's great. And he's been there for years, and he's happy as a clam. I mean, would he have been happier if he got a job at ESPN? Probably, but you know, there's a lot of people who would be, so. You know, so, So, you know, interests, you know, they, you want them to be in the broadest possible manner. We talked about the difference between conditions and interests. The reason we put interests in this is that for some people, interests can be a key motivator for, you know, of going to work. And interests may give us also a hook with employers and a way of making this person seem particular to employer. Just like when we all network for jobs. Well, I mean, I've spent most of my life networking for, I mean, when I get jobs, it's usually through networking. Those, all those kinds of connections are hooks with employers when you're networking. But interests, you know, do not need to be end-alls and be-alls. You know, so it's you have to put in perspective. So we have a list of interests. And then, then we have contributions. So we're looking at from the discovery process. And this is where, as a facilitator, you're there. We have the person who's done the discovery who's facilitating. We usually have a scribe who's going to these charts. And sometimes something will come up that's a skill when people are talking about conditions. And so you move to that chart and you just kind of move around from place to place. And this is the part where everybody glows. Because you've got, through discovery, you've found all these contributions that people can make, and it's all going there, and all of a sudden it's clear, this person is gonna find a job. Exactly when, I can't say, but this person's gonna find a job, we're just gonna match them with the right employer. So that's personality characteristics, skills, things you've actually seen them do. You don't have to make the translation at this point into possible tasks for an employer, but the things that they can do. Credentials they have, you know, maybe they took a, maybe there was like a little training they took. That includes a high school diploma. If they went to college, if they were in a Think College program, I just went to this great session earlier today about the Think College program that the universities are doing, that would be a credential. It shows that they are, that it shows something about their adaptation skills, it shows something about communication, it shows something about participating in classes. All of those things, that's a credential. Experiences they've had, so this is where you're gonna put the particular jobs they've had or the volunteer things that they've done. And then the skills from that are gonna be, from those things are gonna be under skills, and then recommendations they have from people. So all of this is gonna go on either separate lists or on one list, hopefully broken down into categories. It doesn't need to be. Again, we didn't used to break it down into categories, we had it all on one big list. But it's everything, those personality attributes are in there, all of those things. And then, and along with conditions, this is such a central part, is we're gonna come out with a list of tasks that they can do for an employer in an employer setting. Coming again from the, when I say can, these are things that we've seen what they are doing, and then we're making a translation to tasks that we think are in the economy that employers might need. We're not looking for job descriptions. We're not saying this person's gonna be a greeter. We're gonna say this person can do, you know, that one of the tasks they can do is greeting. We're not gonna say that the person's gonna do a clerical job. We're gonna say they can, you know, they're filing, they're scanning, all the specific kinds of things they can do. And then we're gonna come up with a list of potential employers, and that's gonna be where we're gonna start our job development. And very often what we do is we actually prioritize it. So you'll actually have the person come up, because again, this is on a nice sheet of paper, and make stars next to the ones that are most important to them. Or they'll tell us where they wanna put the stars if they don't wanna come up. But they'll, and that's a way of really, again, after you've had this all planning meeting, is making sure that you're really true to what the person wants and what makes sense to them. And one of the things we always say about these planning meetings, if the meeting is owned by the person. So nothing goes on those sheets of paper until the person says, yeah, that belongs there. And there may be rules that need to be worked out with family and individuals and professionals in their lives about that beforehand, but it's really key. Once we do the plan, so what's gonna come out of this planning meeting is a plan. All of those categories, you just take it right from those charts and you put it there, and you've got your plan. You know what tasks you're looking for, you know what conditions you're looking for, you know what employers you're looking for, and your job developer, with a few additional tools, which we're gonna talk about, is ready to go out there. And the job development might be you, the person who's done the discovery, it might be somebody else, depending on how your agency is doing it. If you're a parent helping your child doing it, then it may be both. If you're doing it for yourself, you may be doing everything. Then we create a visual resume. And a visual resume, you're taking, during discovery, one of the things I didn't mention is during discovery, you'll take pictures along the way of things that you think show the person doing at their best or show something about their personality or attributes, and you're going to create a visual resume. Everyone needs some kind of resume. People who don't have a lot of work experience, a visual resume can really bring out for an employer a lot of what they have to offer. So what I'm going to do is just breeze through one visual resume just to kind of give you an example. Visual resumes are done just with PowerPoint. You just insert photos and text. It's really easy. I was completely cowed by it the first time because I am not technologically savvy. Our visual resumes at our agency have gotten better and better because the young people in our office are really good at this, right? It's really quite easy to do. Inserting photos is really quite easy. So this is Nicola. So on the front of her visual resume is this beautiful picture with this beautiful smile. So it's real. How you introduce the person is really important. We'd say something about her education. What order you put things in will depend a lot on the person. This is actually a slide that was just added by her employment specialist because this is the job we got for her through job development. But here it's showing work experience and it's volunteer work, but it's showing her actually doing things in that work setting and showing what she does in that experience. Again, a lot of it is with pictures. Nicola happens to be somebody who has done quite a lot of things, so in this case, it's being presented in terms of work, volunteer experiences in particular, but you could also present it just showing someone in different settings, like just one picture of somebody doing something at a desk and showing what they can do, you know, listing the things that they can do. So just other schools, other skills, other experience. So you always want to have something that really shows like what they have to offer. So here she has a lot of personal attributes and a lot of reliability and that she's offering, and then also the particular tasks that you're looking. Again, you're not saying she wants to be a clerical assistant. You're writing down all the tasks that she could offer. And then in this case, we added interests and hobbies because she's such a delightful person and has so much vibrancy that it comes out. And again, these may be connections with a particular employer, so we have that. She has a certification on cosmetology. She also shows some other kinds of things. And so you're going to go in with that a visual resume. And when you're talking to employers, as you're talking about the individual, you're presenting something that really individualized the relationship from the beginning. And that's why it's so powerful. When we first started doing this, one of the ways that we tried to make this program work after we had, I think I mentioned that when we first started doing it, discovery was going on and on forever, and we just like had to stop. And so we just sort of said, look, you know, we're just gonna do a little bit more, finish up and just go out and do these visual resumes and start going out and meeting employers. And the first time, and so I would go out side by side. I had never done job development in my life either. And I would go out side by side with our employment specialists. And one of the first visits we did is we decided we would just start canvassing a neighborhood where we thought this young woman wanted to be. And while we were canvassing the neighborhood, one of the big institutions in the neighborhood was the Brooklyn Academy of Music, and the employment specialist had wanted to go there. And we went and managed to get ourselves a chance to speak to somebody there. And we went in with the visual resume. And this is a job that didn't happen, actually, because the problem is that the potential employer, the Brooklyn Academy of Music, found a lot of unmet needs and tasks that she could do, but there was literally no space where she could sit. I mean, they literally had no space. But nonetheless, until she got to that point and she realized there was no way she could make this work, the employer's looking at the visual resume, and as she's looking at it, she's using this young woman's name and saying, oh, she could do this, she could do that. So it's like really pulled it in because there was a list of tasks that she could do, and the employer herself could make that translation. So it's a very, very powerful tool. And it's one of the very central tools, aside from the planning meeting, to customize employment. And all of the different strategies for customized employment that I've seen have all used visual resumes. And that doesn't mean that you might not work with someone who says, I don't want a visual resume, then you're not going to do it. But so very quickly, customizing jobs. And this is something that could take like 3 hours to talk about, but we're going to do it in just a few minutes. You'll have this plan that comes out of it. It's really important, if at all possible, for the person who's going to be doing the job development to be at the planning meeting so that they're really absorbing the whole spirit of the planning meeting and getting all the nuances of the planning meeting in addition to the plan. And the starting point are going to be those particular potential employers that were targeted in the meeting. You don't want to go through the whole thing and have the job developer start with something completely different. And it's the discovery that's leading to the customizing, because you're starting with all the things that you found about where the person's at their best. And if you don't use that as your basis, then you might as well not have done discovery. Meeting with employers. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to discover those unmet needs. And you can do it through discussions, you can do it through tours. You're really talking about specific tasks. You're going to be talking about the interests, skills, and contributions of that particular job seeker. It doesn't mean you're not going to do an introduction about customized employment and your agency first, but then you're going to get in and you're talking about a particular individual. You're not saying, do you have any unmet needs generally? Do you have a job for opening? You're really having a conversation with them about what kinds of unmet needs they have that might meet this person. You're showing a resume, and then hopefully, if there are possibilities, you'll set up a time for the person you're working with to meet with the employer. One of the things that sometimes happens to us as we're working with people is that if we haven't really explained the whole process to them, they're wondering why, you know, their friend at a different agency is having many, many interviews, even though they're not getting a job, and they're not having a lot of interviews. We're not really focusing on interviews. We're focusing on finding that job. And then when the employer meets the person, it's more like, you know, they've already figured out that they're going to probably hire this person. It's more like, well, I just want to meet to make sure the person really fits into our workplace. Because that, for all employers, that is key, you know, and it has nothing to do with the person having a disability or not. It's like, can I say, you know, are there rough edges here I can't handle? And some employers can handle a lot and some can handle less. Or is this person, you know, too quiet for my office? Is this person too talkative for my office? Whatever it is, that's a decision that employers make all the time. What the needs analysis is a process where you're finding whatever way makes sense for the employer to get to know about what those needs are that you might be able to match with somebody. So it could be that the employer does it himself. And it's not ideal, but coming from a big city environment that I'm in, we don't have employers very often who want us to do it with them. And sometimes it happens. I suspect that in Tennessee, you're going to get a lot more interest in doing that. It's just a little bit more laid back environment than New York City. But it depends on the employer. And some employers will say, no, you know, I see the task that you think the person can do. I'm going to go back to my department heads, or I'm going to go back and I'm going to think about myself and I'll get back to you. The ideal thing is to do it in partnership with the employer. Do a tour with the employer and say, you know, these are the things we're having in mind. Can we look around together and see what needs you may have that may match the person I'm talking with? And you've already given them examples of the kinds of unmet needs other kinds of employers might have. So you're giving them a sense of what you're looking for. And in the next slide, I'm going to talk a little bit about what kinds of unmet needs we find. And sometimes, you know, the employer may want you to do it. You know, sometimes they'll say, look, I just don't have time for it, but I'm perfectly happy for you to look around my offices and meet my staff and talk to them and see. One of the things we did with the young man I talked about who had who was interested in sports and ended up in the law firm, is that after the employer decided that they really were interested in doing this, which was, you know, it was through a connection, but they really thought, what happened is that the head administrator at the law firm said, my staff is just incredibly overworked. I have a position that's supposed to be an assistant for me, that I've never filled because I don't need it. I have that pot of money. If I sit down with my staff and find out what we can take off their plate and put onto somebody else's job, then we can create a job because I have a pot of money to pay for it. And so we then sat down at a conference room with the head of seven or eight different departments, and we went through them. What was creating the stresses for their staff? Like, what was not getting done, or what was on people's plates that was getting done but was making their days just too long and too stressful? And that's when we pulled out these different tasks for each department. So it can be done just kind of together with discussions with staff or a tour. And so the kinds of needs that we're looking for, and you know, the best way to do this is to think of some examples, but some of it will be something that's just not getting done because everyone's too busy. And so one example might be, you know, again, for another law firm we worked with, they had to have hard copy files of everything, but they needed to start, they were also trying to digitalize files because the system was changing. And so they didn't have anybody, they had staff who were trying to do both, and it wasn't happening. And so when I actually, this was actually my divorce lawyer who I approached on this, and I found out that his firm was merging with another firm, and so I said, would you talk to me about whether you have new needs because you're merging? And when we sat down, he's like, his eyes lit up, and he said, this is perfect. You know, we need someone to digitalize those files, and we're not getting to it. So he, off the top of his head, knew that. And then we've added some other tasks to it, and we sat down with the receptionist, and we sat down with some of the paralegals, and we put together a set of different tasks and different needs for this young man. When we talked about Geneva, who was folding clothes, all of the other staff were trying to fit that into their jobs, their customer service jobs, their cashier jobs. And so we pulled that out, and that was something that she was doing in particular. There are also, it could be, you know, case managers who, on top of the other work they're doing, are doing filing. It could be follow-up calls that need to be made routine tasks that you're taking off of other people. So no one may have ever thought of it as a job opening. But if we all look at our offices or our workplaces, there's lots of things that aren't done or things that are getting done by people who are very stressed, and that's where we're trying to pull the tasks. And then there may be people who have very specific skills, and they're going to be better at that than anybody else. I mean, Geneva's also an example of that because she had this amazing skill at folding. So for her, it kind of fit into two categories because it was taking things off of other people, but she was also going to be able to do it better than anybody else. So these are just kind of, and then they're sort of episodic things that happen periodically. Supplies need to be ordered. They never get ordered in time because it's not anybody's job. And it might be a perfect job for someone who doesn't have a set time that they can come in, but they know they have to come in every week to do those, a certain number of tasks. So there's just a whole assortment of things. And again, there's a lot of descriptions of that on the website, and this is something that, you know, brainstorming with your team about that and brainstorming with the employer, you will find lots of kinds of unmet needs that can be defined. And again, you're going to ask the employer where to start. There's no point in coming in and sort of arrogantly saying, I can figure this out. He knows his business better than you do. He knows who you should talk to. He has a sense of which departments or which people are most stressed by their jobs. So that's where you want to start. So I'm gonna sort of move next into just telling a little more about our journey and what we've learned and the sort of lessons we learned. But just stop. I'm gonna stop a minute. Any questions about the process?
Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about how you get that initial meeting with an employer and how you go about discussing this and not violating ADA, or I don't really understand that process. So I kind of get everything you're saying, but like, do you walk in the door and say, hey, I have somebody with a disability that wants to work, and I mean, what does that look like?
Yeah, I mean, you develop, you know, job developers generally, but for this in particular, you develop a spiel. So what I, you know, and it has to be something that is one that works for you and your personality. So, you know, there's no violation of ADA if you have permission for the person to present that. People can customize jobs. There's no problem. You know, these are not only accommodations, they're just employers have the right to create any job they want. What I like to do is call somebody up. First of all, it always helps if you have a connection, obviously. But if you don't, I like to say to someone, we are doing a real unique new way of helping employers find really, really good matches for things that really need to get done in their business. We're working with people with disabilities who we know have a lot of abilities, but we know that it really works for employers and for them the best if we do these really great matches. I'd like to just have a few minutes to come and talk to you about the work, and then maybe I'll talk to you about an individual person. You know, so it's just, you know, sort of really making it, finding a way of making it interesting. And I always say, because I know that there's like lots of job developers out there for lots of populations, I always like to say to begin with, I just want to assure you right now, I'm not looking for a job, right? I'm not saying that I'm never going to talk to you about a job, but right now I want to talk with you about this interesting approach and start a relationship. The other way to do it is if you have an individual, the other way I would do it is if I have an individual who I think is really, really great for an employer, I might be very specific in the beginning. Say, I do this kind of matching. I happen to be working with a person where, like, this is their dream place to work, and I think they have a lot to offer. Can I just have a few minutes to talk to you about whether there's a way? I understand you don't have any job openings, or you might not have job openings. That's not what I really want to talk about. I want to talk about whether now or down the road, there's a way of finding a match. And then I always say to them, like, I want to talk to you when it's really convenient for you to do it, when you have time. I'm not in a rush.
Do you do any kind of subsidized employment initially?
The only thing, I mean, that's, when a little later I'll talk about sort of work experiences and internships. We actually have been fortunate enough where we are to have a couple of programs that allow people to get paid by the government for a period of time while people, learn tasks. And so we do use that. So, I mean, but we don't lower employment or in any, you know, or sort of, but it is in that sense subsidized by the government. But most of the jobs, most of the jobs we get are not that way. But we do, because it's tools that are available, and sometimes it helps get in the door. I think it's particularly helpful if we have people who we do know are going to take time to train on something to have that. And then there is a tool, I mean, a lot of agencies that do this, and we do have one now, but we didn't initially. There, and I didn't spend a lot of time talking about it because we only have a limited amount of time, but there's an agency portfolio that describes customized employment to people. So you put together an agency portfolio that describes what you're trying to do before you talk about the individual person. And that, I don't need that, right? Because my legal background helps for something, you know? So I don't need that. I can kind of just go in and say what I want to say. But for people who are starting it, it's really helpful. And then for some employers, it's really helpful. And the other thing it does is if you describe for them the approach, you're not finding that they're getting trying to pull you back into a regular labor market approach, where they're not sort of saying, oh, but I don't have a job title. And you don't, you know, so if you've laid it out for them beforehand, then you've said to them, we're doing something different here. And one of the reasons a visual resume is also helpful is it's sort of a signal to the employer that you're doing something different here. And I always link it to saying, this is how we get a really good job match. You know, and employers want that, because there's a lot of businesses, there's a lot of turnover. And if you have somebody who wants to stay there and they're gonna stay there because it's a really good job match, that means a lot to employers. So you're really selling it, but you're not selling it like, you're not selling it to someone who doesn't want to hear it. Because there's no, if somebody's saying to you, I'm not interested, I know this might be an interesting thing, but I don't have the time and I don't really want to, you know, I know what I want. There's no point in talking to them. You'll go on to somebody else.
I get a lot of, I have big work experience, mm-hmm. and just with you in general. And we're in a real rural area. So when you talk about New York and all
right,
these fabulous places that you have to go, I'm like, mm-hmm. yeah, that'd be nice.
but customized, just to tell you, the customized employment, the people who developed it in rural Mississippi, right? Yeah. So we actually, and it works so well, and in some ways it may work better in rural environments because you know the people and everybody knows you. You've got more limitations, but at least you know where to start, right? So it is, despite the fact that I'm talking about it from New York, it's actually was very based in rural areas.
And we get a lot, you know, corporate's not there. So basically, if it's not a local mom and pop kind of, it's not happening. I mean, you can't walk into the mall in our area and even talk about putting anybody there. If they can't go through like the mainstream employment, they're not interested. Part of it is they're not the decision makers, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's part of the barrier that we have in the rural area because they might be here in Nashville, but that's still 3 hours for me, and you're not connecting with that person. You're talking.
Yeah, and I have thoughts about that because we deal with this. We actually deal with the same issue. And if, you know, I can give you my contact information, we can talk about it. We've dealt with that a lot, and there's ways to deal with that. It because it's just a matter of figuring out how to let, because what happens is you may convince the local person, but then it gets diluted by the time it gets to the headquarters. And so there are ways to deal with that.
For a local person, like corporate might be interested in doing something like that, but whoever's the shift manager for that day
right.
doesn't understand what you're trying to do and is not really.
Right.
So I have ideas about that. I mean, we probably can't go into it now, but I'm happy to talk with you about it because we've dealt with it. So just sort of talking about, just a little bit more about kind of our journey and what worked and didn't work and how we got it to work. Because I think from those of you who are providers, there are, whenever you're trying something new, it's harder. It takes more time. And I think because customized employment for a long time has been the new kid on the block, it's really easy for people to say, okay, I tried it a little bit, it didn't work, it's not gonna work. But you have to make investments, and piloting anything new takes a certain kind of investment in certain ways. And so I wanna kind of talk about that because when we did it, when we kind of, after some stumbles, when we actually did it in a very purposeful way with some investment of staffing and some investment in training and mentoring, it just took off incredibly. So, but there is the issue of like piloting new things. So we did initially have Mike Callahan, who is like amazing and can come in and do training in particular agencies. And I know we do lots of trainings, you know, people, ODEP provides trainings, Tennessee provides training. There's nothing like having somebody come in and work with your staff. You gotta figure out if you can afford it. But it's really, really useful to make that investment in terms of being successful. And it doesn't have to be Mike, it could be anybody else, but having somebody come in and do like some one-on-one training and mentoring, if you can afford it, is helpful. That doesn't mean you can't do it anyway, but it's great. We began with I don't really necessarily recommend this, but it's sort of interesting. We decided to have three managers, including our executive director, this was before I came on board to work on this, to actually themselves do discovery with three individuals. It's not a bad idea. It's a way for managers to really know what's involved. I'm not sure it was necessary because they had so much else to do. It took them for a long time to do it, and I think it slowed us down a little bit. But it's an interesting thing to have, you know, three people sort of try it themselves so they know what they're asking staff to do. Then we expanded to a team of two young employment specialists who had been direct support workers and who we had promoted. And they were each working with about 7 to 10 people. I now think that might have been too much to start with a pilot, because we were really starting with a pilot of about 15 to 20 people. I think it's too big. I think you really, I mean, I now have now piloted about, I don't know, many, many projects, a job path. And I like to start with a pilot of 5 to 10 people at the most. I think it's a really, you know, and then you have to figure out how you're gonna fit that on staff. And so I think it was a little too much too soon. if I had to do it again, I'd start with 5 to 10 people. I would have at least 2 people working on it, though, because I think it's learning something new on your own without a teammate isn't great. The problem with that is if you divide it up, then people are doing other things, and then it's, you've got to have a manager who's good at making sure that people are focused, you know, on the customized employment as well as the other things they have to do. So I don't know exactly, but I do think that having at least 2 people working on it together, or at least someone working very hand in hand with a manager if you're piloting, is really important. We did, when we piloted again with our traditional larger employment program to start doing customized employment with people who didn't need long-term supports, we piloted it by having one person whose full caseload was that. And I think the problem is that she got sort of separated from the rest of the team because she was doing something different. I think why we've been really successful with this is because we made a management commitment to it. It wasn't working until I came, and it's not that I'm like such a great manager, it's that we had someone who was devoted to it, and because I was still working part-time, we couldn't afford a full-time manager, so JobPath was kind of lucky that I happened to have a little more time. I was no longer at home with my son as much. I had a little bit more time to focus on it. If you're going to take a portion of a manager, you've got to make sure it's the kind of manager who's going to make sure that they really spend time on that project, because that management investment is really important. People need guidance when they're doing something new, and this discovery process, even though it's structured, it's a little different because people are going out and learning little pieces of things about people, and you need a manager to help talk them through it and think about next steps. It's not like doing just like one situational assessment in one place. So that management mentoring, I do think, is what I think it helped. And then as I went on to do other things and started doing other piloting, we then at that point were able to afford somebody who was like a senior employment specialist who had a master's of special education, and she took over and she mentored people far better than I did. But you know, having that mentoring was very, very key for staff in going through it. And until you've done that, if you're an agency and you've tried customized employment a little bit here and there, and you haven't devoted some really decent management abilities to helping people do it, then you're just not giving it a chance. I think that we were really helped by having our VR counselors really understanding what we were trying to do. And so what we did is, in our reports to our VR, we really explained, you know, why we were doing what we were doing with people, what we were learning. And we didn't make it so detailed that it took forever, but that and we invited them to the planning meetings. And we just let and when we had a success, we explained to them the connection between the discovery and the success so that they understood. And because they understood, if it took us a little longer to find people jobs, they got it because they saw that, yeah, it took us longer because we were matching, but then the results were really good. And so that, I think that relationship, and we were very lucky that we had a couple of really, really good VR counselors who had complex people on their caseloads and were really happy we were doing it. So that partnership was really important. And then I think our strategy for recruiting employment specialists was really helpful because we decided, after a couple of really bad, not in this program, but in our other program, with just seeing people who just weren't interested in the work. They were just sort of career vocational people or career social service people. We said we want to, even if the staff are only going to stay for 3 years and they're going to go on to something else, this is entrepreneurial. Getting people jobs is part of the business community, and we want creative people to be doing this work. And so finding the right team leader was really important, which, as I say, for a while, for a short time, was me, but it really was important to have somebody who really understood, you know, I mean, the director who had a master's of special education, she understood how to listen to people, she understood why discovery was important. Having somebody who really understood the mission was really important. And then creating the team, We you know, it's really, there's a lot of DSPs out there who have a lot of abilities that they can bring to this. good listening, people who are just excited and have done really nice work with people in the community, as finding them really good volunteer opportunities or really new good activities. Those are people who are going to get excited about this work. Diplomacy is really important if you're going to be working with employers. Common sense is, if you're taking steps in discovery and trying to figure out what the next step, it's really important to have common sense. Those are things, you don't have to have like a special degree of any kind to do that, those kinds of things. You just have to have particular kinds of attributes. So these are some questions to ask. Do they like to work with people? Do they understand the mission? I think the third one, do they like to make things happen, is really important. And then Amy, who was the director, who's now an associate executive director at JobPath, she would say, that organization is really important. Because if you're trying to bring in all this information, and then you're also trying to keep track of networking with lots of different employers who, again, it's not like there's a job opening. You may have to keep track of what their thoughts are about different things. Being an organized person is really helpful. We have had, you know, we think of job developers as people who should be tremendously outgoing, but actually some of our best job developers are just very thoughtful, serious, you know, often shy people, right? It's just, so recruiting new staff. Again, it doesn't have to be people in the field. People who show resourcefulness, creativity, people who've done interesting things in their lives. I like I actually find that a resume from someone who's had some social service things, but also spent a lot of time just in business, doing retail, you know, working in retail stores, just feeling comfortable with the business world, is just like a great combination. We had one of our best employment specialists was a graphic designer who was just really comfortable with himself. He was like fundamentally a creative person in every way. He was comfortable with himself, and that what we didn't know is he also had lots of connections, so it kind of helped. He came from this world of all of his family had in some way been involved with various kinds of Catholic charities. There was just like this tradition in his family. And so he just, and as a result, they just like knew this whole community. And he didn't know how useful that was gonna be even. But that's not something you're necessarily gonna find on a resume. But you never know what people talk about. Sometimes artists, college graduates who just are young but have really interesting backgrounds, they've done something interesting. Right now we have someone who's a manager who started as employment specialist who was a paraprofessional in the public schools and really was committed to her students and really understood how to get to know people. Family members of people with disabilities, we've had quite a few of our employment specialists over the years been people who are siblings of people with disabilities, and we've had some parents of people with disabilities and connections to the community. So I'm just going to very quickly go through internships. We've talked a little bit about, we talked about subsidized employment. And one of the things that we're really, really working on now a lot is using discovery as a way of being able to then customize internships that will then help us learn more about the person and give people a really, really positive work experience and possibly a work experience that could turn into a job. And it's been pretty exciting because employers are excited about it. We're able to use some work experience funds from our VR agency to do that. There's, with WIOA, there's just a lot of more funding available for those kinds of work experiences that give people a chance to not do it as volunteer work and give them a training period. But we started with a discovery process. And because we started with a discovery process, we're customizing internships where people are having successes and also becomes, a really good way to build up a resume that shows those successes. So using the internship money that we've gotten, our DD agency actually has an employment training program where they'll actually put people on the DD agency payroll during a training period if the employer thinks there's a good chance that they can hire them. So the last thing, just really quickly, this is my son. And so I just thought I would share my son's situation. I mean, basically, while he was getting support from our agency while he was in college, during one summer, he did some volunteer work at this at a place that provides video equipment and space for filmmakers. we happened to get it because there was somebody in our office who also worked there, and it happened not like, it was not a planful process really. It happened because I said to the staff who were supporting him, what's he gonna do this summer? Have you thought about it? And they said no, and they put it together. It turned out though that they learned a lot about him from that. He started our employment program after he did that volunteer job, and they created this internship through this work experience kind of program where they looked with the employer at a bunch of tasks that he could do, so that it was more than just finding time in the summer to fill up his time in the summer. It was actually thinking about what can we learn from him in that process. It ended up that we then turned it into, you know, we were then able to turn it into a job. And he's now working, you know, he's working about 15 hours a week there. It turns out to have an incredibly nurturing environment. Everybody knew that he needed that because he gets very defensive, and it's worked out really well. But it started with an internship. This young woman's also started with an internship. She's working at a print shop. She had done work experiences in schools that hadn't been well customized, and she showed a lot of anger and you know, was doing a lot of acting out. She was working in a senior center doing some maintenance work. She wasn't interested. She was unhappy with it, and she showed it. She loves art. I've now gotten to know her mother better because her mother's actually become a support worker at our agency. Her mother's really interested in art. She takes my son Alex to all these art things, which he's never been interested in art before, so that's really interesting. But anyway, she helps do tasks around this print shop for the artists who are there. And it's the same kind of maintenance tasks, but it's in an environment that she's excited by. That's where interests were a motivator for her. But it started out as an internship that was paid for, and the employer was able to try it out. So this is kind of a new model that we're trying to do of discovery, development of a customized internship. Even if the employer isn't saying they're going to hire at the other end, gives us more information, gives people a really good positive work experience in a place where they can thrive, and then we can use that for job development. So there we fit it into the time. Questions, thoughts?
How long have you been doing it?
So we've been doing this now. We started in 2002. So we've been doing it for about 14 years. The first couple of years we stumbled around quite a bit. So I would say we've been doing it in a successful way, starting in about 2004, but got more and more successful. I would say that by about 2009 or 2010 was the point where we sort of looked at our two programs and we said, you know, we're doing a lot much better job with customized employment than the other program, and we switched. So we've been doing it with all the programs since about 2012.
And you're in all five boroughs?
We're in all five boroughs. And although we don't do Staten Island very much. It's too much travel for us with the ferry.
And you talked about the pilots that you had. So who funded the pilots?
For the customized employment?
Yeah.
Well, the pilot was just funded through regular supported employment funding for this one. We've done some pilots where we've gotten foundation funding, but we didn't need to do it for this. We were able to make it work with that. We're doing a few pilots now with young people who are still in school, and the funding from the government for that hasn't quite gotten going yet, and so we've gone to some foundations for that, and we're matching that with a little bit of city funding.
And you talked about the state paying for the internships, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think you were talking about that. So is that through like OMRDD, or was that through?
It's now OPWDD, but yeah.
Yeah.
So there's two. So there's work experience funding. There's work experience funding as part of the youth programming for VR. So we're able, and they've actually will provide job coaching support, not as much as we'd like them to, but some job coaching support. So that is a little bit easier to use than the OPWDD DD system funding, because they don't require an absolute, like the employer saying, we know we can put them on payroll down the road. The DD system doesn't require an absolute, but they want to be pretty certain that the employer has the funding to be able to take it over in payroll. So we've now got it from two systems. And, you know, the nice thing about it, when it comes from the DD system, we have job coaching that will last through 6 months, and then once the person has a job, then the supported employment funding will come in. Through the VR, we're only getting, as I say, about 20 to 30 hours of coaching, so it's not as good for that point of view, but it's more open-ended. Yeah?
About how many hours would you say your job developers, you know, hang out and spend time with the
person? So the discovery period, I would say it's an average of 25 to 30 hours total over about a 6 to 8 week period. And again, the reason is that you could do it in a shorter period of time, but that requires a lot of partnership with all the people in their lives to make sure that you can fit it all in. But 25 to 30 hours in the beginning, the first time you do it, it'll take longer because it's just, there's a learning curve.
And do they see that as intrusive, like,
the 25 to 30 hours is not in the home alone. It's like you're going to spend about an hour in people's homes, maybe an hour the first time, and then maybe you'll go back for another visit like later for an hour. People will feel like it's intrusive if you don't explain it well. So part of the intake process is letting people know what the whole thing looks like. And I always tell our staff, like, let people know that you're going to end up with a planning meeting so they don't feel like, what are you doing? You're just hanging out with me. What's going on? You sort of say this, explain the process, and you say, okay, let's set a tentative time for the planning meeting. If we don't fit it all in, then we'll change it, but we know that this is going to happen, and we're not coming. You know, a lot of people who've had to depend on the public system, they feel invaded, right? So you say, I know you've had people do home visits before. This is different. I'm just coming because I want to see you at your best, or I want to see your son and daughter at their best. And the best way I can do that is to see what they're like in an environment that they're most comfortable with, where, you know, we're really seeing what their lives, you know, look like. You can even say to them, please, if you start feeling like I'm evaluating you, push me out the door. You know, I think if you explain it to people, they understand. There are people who will say no, and if they don't, you can't. But most of the time, people will. And the biggest mistakes I've ever made is when people say I don't have time for a discovery process because I urgently need a job, to say that's okay, because it never works. You need to know people. Any other questions? Yeah.
We do a form of your customized mm-hmm. for people with traumatic and acquired brain injuries. And we had a young lady who came in, and she was animate. She did not want to work because nobody would allow her to take her Barbie doll with her. And her parents kept saying she has to work. She kept saying no. And so what our job developer did was find her an office where she could put the Barbie doll, and nobody goes back there. She's alone. She loves it. She's happy, and Barbie's with her.
There, and there you did. They turned. What would seem like an obstacle into a condition. The condition is she needed to work in an environment where that she could do that.
You know? I recently applied for a job at the mall a couple months ago, and because of my limitations and because of they're not willing to let a job coach helped me out. They weren't interested. It's like, okay, I'm really coming in this door all the time. So what do you do about that?
Okay, so there's a couple of things. One, you know, there's one of the questions. You know, one of the questions is how long do you knock on the door of somebody who you're not going to make progress with, right?
Right.
And a lot of that depends on how big a community you have and what your options are. Because you want to work someplace where they get your value, right? And they're not worried about the accommodations they need to make. But job coaching is a right. There may be situations where job coaching is not okay, an employer doesn't have to provide it if it's not reasonable given their setting. And there are situations where that happens. If there's no room, if there really isn't any room for a job coaching, they'd be able to say that. But job coaching alone is not a basis for an employer not hiring. The question is, you know, do you in your life want to take that on as a point of challenge with that particular employer? And that's a personal decision. Do I think that it is, if job coaching is that, is the reason why they have denied it? That's problematic. That's legally problematic. But they may have there may be reasons that are, the way the law is, there may be reasons why they can say that they don't need to provide it. There was a lawsuit against Home Depot in Long Island some years ago that the plaintiffs won because the person was actually working in the job and they didn't let the job coach come in and help solve the problem. And the judge found in favor of the plaintiffs against Home Depot. So, you know, it is a progressing part of the law. You know, you have to decide whether it's worth it to you to take that on. That's a personal decision. And then you never know. They may come back at you and have really good reasons, like there is no room, and I don't know. You can't know until you actually are looking at the particular place to see that. You know, we've had employers say they don't want to provide job coaches, and they'll say it's because of security reasons and things like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't think that is a reasonable barrier. I think there are ways around that, but again, you don't know what, if you take it on legally, you don't know what you're going to find out about what their needs are.
Right.
But there is, you know, there's a developing area of law, and it's important. It's really important because job coaches are, you know, not only job coaches, but even job support. If you needed support, you know, for physical things, you know.
That would be my issue, physical.
That's right. And if there are ways you need support, that might not be job coaching, that's personal attendant, but then that may be something that has to do with space.
Safety.
Right, exactly. So I don't think that that's grounds but again, it's not an absolute. The ADA is a balancing between the accommodation and whether it's reasonable given the employer's needs. You know,
yes.
It's a factual. Okay. But I'm happy to talk to you about it more.
Okay.
Anything else? Thank you, everybody. It was a pleasure to spend some time with you all.